So today I would like to talk on quite an unusual aspect of power and Shakti. Now, most of us do not realize that power or Shakti comes in multiple forms and the powers interact with each other, and that is what keeps the universe going, you know. So intellect is a power. Knowledge is a power. Strength is a power. They are all Shaktis. Beauty is a Shakti. Nobody needs to be told that. We can observe it every day. Yeah. And each one of these powers or each one of these Shaktis has a sort of guiding principle or manager or God or Devta, that's what we call it, but it's basically only means the consciousness that guides it, the consciousness that operates it. So maybe I'll do a whole series of talks on the powers, you know, a whole series of talks on the Shaktis, but today I'd like to start with the basic one, money. Yeah, since that's what gets everybody excited, and also because it is in many ways the most misunderstood power. It is the most misunderstood Shakti. Now, when we say Shakti and when we say how the money functions or how it flows, it's a sort of vibration of energy that enters you, resides in you, and also goes away. Now, you cannot grab hold of a Shakti and control it. Number one, you can make your system, your mind, your body, your emotions, your ki, your brain, you can make it conducive to the Shakti so that when it enters you, you can utilize it maximum, but you cannot grab hold of it and insist, no, now you stay permanently in me. Yeah, because it is not like that. And it is not that it comes only once. Shaktis ebb and flow. The powers, there are certain times when your intellect is at a peak, there are certain times when your strength is at a peak, there are certain times when your vocabulary, your speech is a Shakti. No, the Shakti ebbs and flows. Now, okay, for a guy like me, Vak is always easy. So the Shakti is pretty strong. It is pretty predominant. But I also know there are days when it's much better. And there are days when it's not so good. Like last week, that talk was extraordinary, except that the computer dhoka de diya. Yeah, so you know that the Shakti was very different that week. It was very palpably different. Very obviously different. So the money Shakti, if you become intense enough, if you become progressed enough in your yoga, the money Shakti has a golden hue, golden color. And the vibration enters you basically through your Muladhara and your Swadhisthana, your two lower chakras. Which is why if your two lower chakras are damaged, you very rarely get money. But here is the extraordinary thing. If your heart chakra is closed or damaged or resistant, or you've suffered a lot of emotional trauma, the money Shakti is blocked from entering. So even though the Shakti operates in the two lower chakras, the funny part is if your heart is not functioning, your heart chakra is not functioning, your anatta is not vibrating correctly, or there is a lot of trauma, or there is lot of pain and suffering and things like that. It's not necessary, but very often abundance doesn't come for that one reason. Now, money is not quite the same as abundance. You know, we say Lakshmi is the goddess of wealth. Wrong. Wealth is an aspect of the abundance which she brings, and that abundance, that overall bounty that comes to you is known in our culture as Shri. When a person is operating at the peak of efficiency, effectiveness, everything in life is going well, to Shri ka pravesh hua hai. Lakshmi brings Shri. So actually, Lakshmi bhi kehna galat hai, kyunki it is Shri Lakshmi. Now, Shri Lakshmi is not exactly the same as Vishnu Patni Lakshmi, you know. People make that mistake also, but that is another story for another time. Yeah, so when you are in Chidambaram Nataraja temple, they tell you that this is the form of the goddesses Saraswati, this is the form of the goddesses Lakshmi, this is the form of the goddesses Kali. They tell you that. You know? So that confusion of Vishnu Patni Lakshmi, the wife of Vishnu with Lakshmi, is not necessarily so. Not necessarily so, because you know, whenever she takes avatar, she doesn't have a very good time of it. You know? And she was born as Sita, you know, gets banished, gets kidnapped, can't be with the husband, has to bring up the kids alone. Then she says Rukmini, she has slightly better time of it, but her husband has about 1607 other wives, you know. So that's not exactly Shri, and Shri is that quality of success. Shri is the Shakti of success, that when somebody is really in the zone, as they call it, and you can see that they are radiating a certain thing, you know, that is when Shri is there. Which I've said this before, but it's always worth repeating. That is the reason why kings used to play dice. They used to gamble on Diwali. Because if the Shri is with them, they will win. If they start losing, it means that the Shri has decided to abandon them. So that is the reason why people gamble on Diwali, just to check, is the Shri with me, you know. So the Shri Lakshmi is a particular kind of vibration, but usme health, happiness, you know, good interpersonal relationships, family relationships, children, all those things, nice life, comfort in surroundings, all those things constitute Shri. Whatever you would think is a perfect life, out of which, of course, all these things require money, which is why they keep showing her pouring out the money. That is only a symbol that you can get all the good things of life. But she is not the power behind money, not really. She is the power behind abundance. She is the power behind the concept of Shri, which is a very brilliant concept. Maybe one day I'll talk about Shri a lot, but today let's stick to money. So the power behind money, or the energy behind money, or the guardian of money, the Lord, the Devta of money, Dhanesha as he is called, Dhanka Ishwar, is Kubera. This is Kubera. Yeah? I don't think people can see very well because of the light. Okay, not a problem. This is Kubera. Now, Kubera is normally like a king. He's always presented as a king because he's rich. And he has very interesting vahana. He has a mongoose as a vahana. You know, now the reason why he has a mongoose as a vahana is because treasures were supposed to be guarded by snakes. And the mongoose is the only animal that would venture into those, you know. So that is one aspect. And in his other hand, he has that, what is that, pomegranate? What is that? The amlakha, that thing with the anar, kya kehte hain angrezi mein? Pomegranate, yeah. He has that anar in his right hand. Because if you look at the anar, it has hundreds of seeds. Yeah? And each one of that can grow into one. So, you know, yeah, when he gives you that, he gives you something that will keep multiplying. So that is the reason in his right hand he holds that. It's very interesting. There's this magnificent Kubera statue in the Jain caves at Ellora. Magnificent, meaning larger than life size, about 7 foot tall, red color, everything. Somebody went and chiseled off the anar from his hand. This is the reason. Anar is the symbol of abundance. Anar is the symbol of multiplication. Wo badhte jayega. Plus, it's very healing. Yeah, but plus it's very healing, na? It's always, you know, it's given to people recovering from illness. So it has all those multiple qualities, you know, yogic, Ayurvedic qualities, quite other than the. But it is so funny to see that one in Ellora, you know, that just chiseled it off straight away. So because it was probably an energized murti, and when the murti is energized, the shakti in the Kuber murti does stay in the anar. So somebody decided ki ab to koi aata nahi hai, let me take it away. Now he is also shown as his foot is on a shankha, on a conch shell. His foot is on a shankha. Now the reason why that is there is because that his, you know, the conch is a symbol of the respiration. It is a symbol of victory over the prana. He controls the breath perfectly, which means he's a self-controlled person. Plus he has this little tummy, you know, that is also basically because we used to live in such harsh conditions, a person who could grow a pot belly was really, really rich, you know. So that sense, and he is also known as the Digapala. The Digapala means guardian direction, guardian protector. He is the Pala of the Diga, he is the Digapala of the North. He protects the area of the North, which is in India, that is Kailasa, Himalaya, Shiva. So he is also known as Ishanamitra, he is a friend of Shiva, you know. Which is quite funny because he's the richest man in the universe and Shiva is Patehal anyways, you know, the way he wanders around there. And again, people do not know this, but Lanka did not belong to Ravana. Lanka belonged to Kubera. He and Ravana have the same father. And his name is actually Vaishravana. Then the word Ravana became so completely unpopular that then his name became Kubera, you know. They started because they didn't want to be associated. Actually, his name is Vaishravana. His original name is Vaishravana. He is the elder brother of Ravana. Yeah, so when Ravana took over Lanka, then Shiva told, because Ravana was Shiva Bhakta and Kubera complained that what is this? Shiva said, you come and stay with me now. Come and stay in my place. So then he built what is called Alkapuri, which is the secret city of wealth. Now all these have very deep tantric symbolism that he abandoned and then he went to Alkapuri, and so there is a whole sadhana which enables you to go to Alkapuri. I'm not getting into all that. There's a way of reaching to that level of wealth and power and everything. So that is the symbol. So when people worship Lakshmi for wealth, if what you really want is wealth, money, you're making a mistake. Because she will either give you in comprehensive format or not at all. She won't give you in this narrow focus zone. Narrow focus you want, then you have to ask Kubera. Which people don't really understand. People don't really understand. And for some reason, I do not know why, there is a tradition that we do not worship Kubera. There are no Kubera temples. It's always been a dream of mine to make a Kubera temple one day. Let's be honest about it. Come on. It sort of symbolizes to me the trouble that India has. We have this fascination and repulsion with money, you know. We are all secretly fascinated by it, but publicly we'll all pretend to be above it, and you know, money is not important, money cannot buy you love, and you know, all that. So, we have a very strange relationship with Kubera. It's certainly true. We have a very, very strange relationship with him. And even the Pushpaka Vimana was actually his. Ravana stole that also. So, you know, that's about Kubera. But the thing is, I've seen this, I've recommended Kubera Murti to so many people, I energize and give them, and it really makes a difference. Because they don't really get anywhere with the Lakshmi thing, because that's not what they want. That's not even what they need. They basically, at this moment in their evolution, Nagad Narayan, they want money. You know? And of course, Kubera is very famous in another context, that he lent money to Vishnu to get married. So today in Balaji temple, you know, they are still paying money. All the donations we make apparently go to paying off the interest, you know. At least that's the story they tell you. I'm like, he's made you so rich. Ek chota sa kahin ek Kuber ka mandir. No gratitude. Well, you know, whatever. In their own Sthala Purana, it is very clear that the original Devta was the Varaha Murti. And Balaji asked him to move. And that original Murti is still there in the corner. You know, you can see the Varaha Murti temple is still there. But he originally was the Devta of the hills. So, you know, paise ke samne sabhi ko jhukna padta hai. Also, because the evolution of the form, the evolution of the rupam of the devta, the Varamurti had done whatever it had to do. Because Varamurti, by the way, is almost just like worshipping Kubera, maybe better also. For health, for family, for finances, for married people, if you are Vaishnava, there is nothing better than the Varamurti. It is the best form. But, you know, all these sciences are lost. People have forgotten these sciences, you know. So, wo gayab ho gaya, that whole Varamurti Swarupa did not serve the purposes of the larger culture. So, people forgot. Now, people are slowly rediscovering. North India used to be full of Varamurti temples. All demolished because, you know, the Muslims used to get horrified. Pig's face. So all destroyed. But Varamurti was actually one of the most popular forms of God in India. This will surprise you today. The oldest temple in India is still in Kerala. It is 5,000 years old according to the inscriptions. Varamurti ka mandira. So Varamurti is one of the most ancient form of God. So that whole Sthala Purana in Tirupati is very interesting in that it literally shows how it is changing, you know. How the worship is changing. But to come back to Kubera, so, you know, the Kubera worship is quite easy. The mantras are also very simple. I'm not going to tell you. But it's a worthwhile understanding of the Shakti, you see. Because if you don't understand the Mani Shakti, if you don't understand the Mani power, your relationship will be wrong. Your relationship will not work as it should work. And Kubera is the real guy. So why are you wasting time? Go straight to where you want or what you want, you know, because the way the money flows is quite dramatic, you know. You have to have that intention very clear. You have to have that concept of I want money, and it must be very clear in your mind. Now, most of us, because of our cultural conditioning, especially in this, all over the world, the cultural conditioning is that to be rich is somehow, you know, a rich person is always looked at with suspicion. You know? So you have to be in your consciousness very that money thing should be predominant, otherwise money does not come. It should become very important to you that money comes. So the Kubera form is a help. The Kubera form is an aid to that consciousness. But there is something deeper about money, and that is the reason why people have all these issues with it. The Mani Shakti is not a free Shakti. It is not in the control only of the Daivik or the divine forces. The Asurik or the demonic forces have lot of control over it. It is true. So very often people are responding to the fact that the Asura Prakriti is very strong in Mani. Even today, there are teachers, there are masters who will not physically touch money with their hand. Because the money has that much, that Asuric vibration is so strong in that. The demonic vibration is so strong in that. It's very strange, you know, this guy Yuri Geller, he used to bend spoons and all that. He was very famous. He mental, mind control guy. He also never physically touches money. He refuses to touch money because it actually diminishes his capabilities. So it's that strong, that Asuric thing is that strong in money. So this has been going on for a long time, since spiritual people would retreat into caves and monasteries and Himalayas and ashrams all over the world. Whether they were Hindu or Christian or Muslim, they were all doing the same thing. They would retreat. And then those who had money would give, you know, and wo Jain hota hai ya whatever, the Vaishya community subsidized basically Buddhism and Jainism in the first few hundred years. So spiritual people sort of dissociated themselves from money. In fact, even today, it is the commonest thing. No? You've heard it yourself. He is only interested in money, or he is very money-minded. And you know, this is the greatest catastrophe, that spiritual people stop talking about sex and spiritual people stop talking about money. That people of higher consciousness started treating these two topics as ichichi. And they are both the lower chakras, by the way. Yeah. They are both the lower chakras, you know, and they are like, eh, nahi, nahi. And then we wonder why we are poor. If the people with the highest vibratory consciousness are rejecting these two vital things in life, then kya hal hone wala hai desh ka? What is likely to be the outcome of the country? So, in the 20th century, Sri Aurobindo, because he was completely fearless, he sat and he thought about this. He meditated on this whole thing. And he came out with an agenda. He came out with the adesh, a command to everybody in yoga. Not his command, it was just something that he said needed to be done. And he said, it is now our responsibility. Every single person who is in integral yoga, every single person who is in this business of evolutionary consciousness, we must free the money shakti, the money power, from the grip of the asuric forces, and we must reclaim it for the divine. Because he understood very clearly that money is very often in the hands of really bad people. You know, and they are under the prompting of the asuric shaktis. You know? I mean, you just have to look at the way businesses are run. You just have to look at all this fracking and the kind of, you know, all those financial scandals with the stock market and things like that. So, it's a difficult task, because for about 2000 years, the spiritual people have conceded the money power into the hands of the most greedy people. Because, you know, even if you are a spiritual person, if people are consistently criticizing you for a certain behavior, then you'll stop doing that behavior. So, Aurobindo was the first yogi to say, this idiocy should cease. This foolishness should stop, and right now. And he actually, you know, people don't realize what all we owe Aurobindo. He actually entered into combat with the Asura Shakti, with the Asura Prakriti, to free the money up. And to a large extent, he freed it up, because he noticed another thing, that genuine spiritual communities were not getting any money. Wherever there were pakhandi and fraud people, they are getting all the money, because the asura prakriti is flowing there. Today, because of what he has done, the minute a spiritual community becomes little famous, money is not a problem. In fact, they have so much money that they have to start creating hospitals and trusts and schools and universities to deal with it. And this is entirely Sri Aurobindo's gift. Entirely. He was the man who freed it up, and you know, we just don't recognize what we owe to him. We don't recognize what we owe. And the counterattack was so great that he even broke his leg, you know. They even managed to break his leg. It was a solid psychic attack on him. So he said, I have done my part, now it is the part of everybody else. And he kind of stopped whatever it was he was doing, but he basically, he has left it as a very clear adesh. What he said, and you know, even today yogis are afraid to say it. What he said is, it is everybody's duty to make as much money as you possibly can and then use it for good purposes. Because every time somebody of higher consciousness grabs hold of the money power, we are rescuing, we are removing that much, that demonic control over it or that. You know, and I've been a corporate trainer for 20 years and I can tell you, Asura Prakriti is what operates. You know, the kind of people who get successful are not decent human beings. The kind of people who become, you know, so this is a problem, and because nobody took it seriously except for Aurobindo's people, and you know, people are like, our organization is doing well, oh, that is all the grace of the Guru, it is the grace of God, whatever. They don't understand that the whole vibration has shifted because of one man and his efforts. And nobody is still saying that it is a spiritual responsibility to become abundant and prosperous. Because if anybody says that, immediately the criticism will come, money-minded. And I am saying, yes, of course, thank you. You know, whenever somebody says you're money-minded, that is such a nice compliment. I'm so happy today. Of course. Actually, a special rates, double. Now, this, I am sure this is going to shock a lot of people. This is going to upset a lot of people. Because, you know, the whole mindset is, if you are not Fatehal Bhuka Nanga, you are not spiritual. I am like, kis angle se Baba? Have you looked at the Vedas and Upanishads and who are the gurus there? Who are the teachers there? Unka kya kaam kaj tha? What they have? What was their social position? What was their, you know, but this whole mindset that unless you are starving and unless you are in rags, and you know, in many ways, one of the saddest instances of this, because with this mindset they did Gurudroha, and it's really sad. You know, the Nepalese royal family, they always had these Nathpanti fellows as their family guru, the Kula Guru. Swami Rama was the royal family's Kula Guru. You know, and who was that? That Queen Aishwarya and King Birendra, yes? Yeah. During their time, they didn't like his independent nature because he was not doing much chamchagiri to them. And so, the Queen made the mistake of giving a whole lecture on what is a true yogi, because Swami Rama used to wear silk, because silk is very high level conductor of prana shakti. And with a film star, he was like a film star in his attitude, and you know, he used to come to Bombay and stay in 5-star, you know. Now, if his disciples put him up in a 5-star, why should he not? But no, he should. You know, I remember Swami Chinmayananda saying that sannyasa only means that if facility is not available, don't complain. It doesn't mean if there is a comfortable bed, sleep on the floor. You know, he was really steamed up, you know, he was really angry. So this lady went on and on, the Queen went on and on criticizing Swami Rama. He didn't say anything, his disciples counterattacked very hard. And she even sent them to one Fatehal Bhuka Nanga person saying, this is the true yogi kind of thing. So Swami Rama just said something, and you know, at that time it looked like sour grapes, but today it has been proved to be true. And that is what it gripped my heart ki Gurudroha, if you do, what happens? He just said, our parampara has lifted the protection from the Nepalese royal family. And this was printed long before, this book was printed long before, but you know what happened, their own son took cocaine and murdered them, and today is there an, even the royal family has been abolished. Just because of this cultural conditioning about Bhukananga, and that Bhukananga Fatehal is authentic spirituality. You see, because they did not, I really don't know if I should say this, but you know, about 25% of the national revenue used to be spent on the royal family. They didn't have a problem with that. So the relationship with money was obviously an asubh prakriti relationship. And Swami Rama is famous. He was like a magician. He, anytime money was needed, he just got on the phone for 3 hours, the money would be there tomorrow. He had that correct understanding of the Money Shakti. He was really, really famous. But it stunned me that just out of cultural conditioning, not even asking the man, why are you like this, Swamiji? Aap kyon pehante hain? He could have explained, no? Just launching into criticism. So, without knowing what you're talking about, if you criticize your guru and you're demolishing the faith of other disciples in the guru, then these kind of unintended consequences happen. It when I first read that and then I thought about what happened, I said, my God, that is all he said. And apparently his face had become all grim and silent, and he just said that we have withdrawn our protection from the royal family. Only one Hindu country there was in the world, even that, just because of this foolishness. So, to come back here, to come back to the Shakti of how money, remember, money enters from the Muladhara and it enters from the Swadhisthana, basically the Muladhara. So if your Muladhara chakra is not strong, if your Muladhara chakra is not functioning, the money won't come. But the filter for that Shakti to enter is your heart. So if you are in an emotionally traumatic condition, now people might wonder, it's not like rich people are particularly happy, yes, but they don't feel bad about themselves. They might be under stress, they might be, but you know, what people without money feel is they feel worthless, they feel valueless, they feel like our life has no meaning, and all those things become very, very serious barriers to the influx of prosperity. And the Mani Shakti anyways is the most chanchal. We know that. It is the most difficult to, because you know, it has this very typical, it is astonishing to see. Here it is coming. I don't need to do anything. Only all kinds of work will come my way. All kinds of income will come my way. Here it is going. Agle mahina kharcha jyada hone wala. And it's a golden color. You know, the vibration is a golden color. And you can actually see it exiting. And I'm like, hello, abhi kaam nahi hua. Please stay some more. Nahi. And it's very frustrating. It's very frustrating, this ebb and flow of money. But if you recognize that, then very soon, and if you keep doing your yoga, very soon you will know, okay, here it is coming in again. Maximize my effort at that time. And if it is gone out of you, don't bother at that time. Because aap kuch bhi karoge, khuda paad nikla chuha, you know. Yeah? The mountains are in labor, there shall be born a ridiculous mouse. You know, that's the original Latin saying. So this took me a long time to understand that there is a sort of natural rhythm in these matters. It is just like ocean waves, you know. It comes flooding in and then it recedes. It comes flooding in and then it recedes. Usiliye usko laya kehte hain. That's why it's called laya. It's called the rhythm. The money is the most rhythmic thing. And people who hit that rhythm, now, of course, you know, many, many lifetimes you have spent only brooding and dreaming about money, then you get one lifetime where you're given all the money you can deal with, you know, because that's become your vasna samskara, there is nothing else in you. But I'm talking about normal people, how do we understand this thing about money? So, of course, the answer to most things is intensify your yoga, because then all these knowledges also come. But very often when people complain that we have no luck, they are not wrong, they are correct. Because their vibration only is such that it is preventing that golden energy to come in. And also probably their lower chakras are damaged. It is very clear sometimes, you know, the lower chakras are damaged, so the money cannot stay. Even if it comes, there is no receptivity, there is no magnitude, or there is no space for that. The container is not large enough to hold that. So, pakad mein nahi aata hai, toh it just goes back. You know, if it cannot find a firm footing in your body, which is the purpose of yoga, the purpose of the sadhana, the purpose of the kriya, is to expand yourself. Yes, of course, we hope that the spiritually transforming shakti will come, but you can use it also for money also. Yes, yesterday I was saying that there was this very famous master in Europe in the early part of the 20th century called Gurdjieff, and he would never accept people as disciples who did not have certain social level success. Because he was like, the lack of that success, the lack of that money will derail them later. Because that lack is so vital, ki it will come and destroy the and you know the shakti will grow, because you do the processes, your shakti will grow, you will become, and then that contradiction between what you desire and what you are will become too great and you will get derailed. So he would never teach people who had not, for this one reason. And he also understood this ebb and flow business about money. In fact, all yogis understand, all spiritual people actually understand. Now, so very often that sense of where are we? Now, I'm not talking about normal financial sense, and you know, obviously one should not be extravagant, one should not be a miser, because both are wrong. But certainly people are extravagant for no reason. People don't know how to manage the money. Those are all different things. Those are all practical things you can do. But the way abundance enters, or the way money enters, is unique. At least from a yogic perspective, it is very unique, and people just have no clue. People just have no clue. And it can be increased. You can increase it with your sadhana, and you know, you can actually focus on your two lower chakras and make them stronger. You can actually focus on seeing the ebb and flow rhythm. It took me a long time to understand. Ever since I started having our friend Kubera, then I started understanding these things. As understanding how this flows. But yeah, to me the more important thing is that Aurobindo gave that adesh, he gave that command that money is to be liberated from the, yeah, so you know, that people of higher consciousness, it is their duty to become rich. Main paisa batar raha, I did not know ki sadhana bhi ho raha hai. Yeah, making money was a sadhana also, I did not know that. Yes, it is a sadhana, and the most difficult sort of sadhana, because the way of getting derailed is so easy there, you know. Yeah, but for me it is very clear, you know, I will never say anything about people who are interested or want to be abundant and comfortable in life. That is a good, that is a spiritual aspiration. I will never tell people don't be greedy, and that's a spiritual aspiration. It's a really good thing. Yes, you must keep the other sides up also. If you're just, you know, there's a word money grubbing. You know what a grub is, no? Grub is a worm. Yeah, so you know, if you're grubbing for money, then your consciousness has already fallen. But to make money as a person in higher consciousness, the problem is the minute you get into spirituality, you start all this dikhawa, you start all this display. Oh, now I don't care about those things. You know? Because you get a lot of validation for that. You get a lot of approval for that. You know, and to say that, no, the money is needed because it is important and so much good can be done with that. Immediately, there is a lot of criticism. There is a lot of horrified reactions to that. I don't care. I am an Aurobindo guy. He has given the Adesh. I will do it all my life. I will teach all who come to learn from me also. The same thing. So, you know, in future, like I said, anybody says money-minded, you should say, yes, thank you. You know, what a nice compliment. So, did not know this, yeah? Paisa batorna sadhana hota hai. Okay? Sarvam shivam.